Now, for most of my career, doing theory has been about trying to get to the root of what we mean by democracy, drawing on its history, its practice in different countries, and more strictly theoretical debates about key democratic ideas like inclusion and equality. Now, for the most part, my writing on democracy's imperfections and its potential led me back to the old Winston Churchill line. "Democracy," said Churchill, "is the worst system devised by the wit of man, except for all the others that have been tried from time to time." I think it's fair to say that in debates like that, a number of political theorists stick closely to the more abstract theoretical debates. And that work often can be brilliant, it can often be sophisticated, but to my mind, it can often also be seriously detached from real-world concerns. So trying to think abstractly and with real discipline is a vital part of the job, but my approach has always been to try to stay close to current events and to recent histories. For example, recently trying to get under the skin of day-to-day debates in the UK and the USA about democratic responses to the so-called war on terrorism. Or as a colleague of mine likes to say when he listens to George W. Bush, the war on tourism. Tourists can be pretty bad, but I don't think they deserve that. I also take the view that political theory is something that's done well beyond university gates. Everyone does political theory in a sense. Each of us, when voting, for example, is aware of terms like democracy, equality, and freedom meaning something to us and to those around us. The radio and TV producer Michael Fox and I put this notion to the test when we made a CD for an open university course 2 years ago. So we're standing in the bitter wind outside Westminster asking, has to be said, slightly suspicious passers-by, what they thought of democracy, freedom, equality, and so on. And we got varied answers. But everyone had something to say, mostly coherent and often thoughtful ideas about how some political values matter and others don't, and whether our current crop of political leaders live up to those values. We are also, in a way, surrounded by theory. I think if you look just underneath the surface of newspaper headlines and TV news, you find scattered thoughts on what government is, what it's for, how it's working. Just the kind of scattered thoughts that are not political theory exactly, but they clearly are its raw ingredients. Theory is not just a job for university lecturers. It's not an activity that belongs outside some real world. It's part of our everyday lives, and more than that, it helps to shape what all of us think our real world is and what it can be. The lecturer's advantage is simply training in the tools to try and rethink the categories we used to try and make sense of politics. And doing theory well is demanding, and for me, I just regard it as a goal not yet reached. So theory sounds, the word itself sounds scholarly and it sounds ordered. Sometimes it is. Or at least the finished product can be. More often than that, though, it's messy, and inspiration comes from unexpected places. In recent times, my own work has been provoked by self-portrait paintings, a Borges short story, the writings of Ralph Waldo Emerson, and Big Brother. So you might think the TV Big Brother is a crass, repetitive, exploitative celebration of mediocrity and narcissism. And you might be right. You might think it captures and satirizes instant celebrity and offers spontaneity, reality, and moments of genuine, surprising drama. And you might be right there, too. I come neither to bury Big Brother nor to praise it. George Orwell, I suspect, would be both appalled and fascinated. But one thing that interests me is the layers of representation that Big Brother contains, how suggestive it is about representation, the kind of questions that it makes us ask. For example, the Big Brother House has been contrasted favourably, believe it or not, to the House of Commons. The argument goes, not necessarily one that I share, but the argument goes that people in it look and behave more like real people. They seem real and accessible. If the House of Commons politicians could be more authentic, a word that's often used in this context, fewer people would be, so it goes, disillusioned with politics. Secondly, are the Big Brother House residents acting? Are they representing a particular view of themselves to us? Or is it their authentic selves that we see, as the notion of reality TV suggests? And what is it that we do see? I know lots of people can't bear to watch it, so I'm having a very inclusive we here, and ignoring those separate set of issues. So what do we see? Big Brother is presented to us as if we, the audience, are Big Brother. We see everything. But of course, we don't see everything. We see what the TV producers want us to see. We see a representation, not a reality. And moving on, we live in a surveillance society. Being watched is a key part of our condition. Big Brother, I think, is certainly symbolic of much in that sense. They're watching each other, we're watching Big Brother watching them, and watching them watch each other. The show's producers watch us, the consumer audience, very carefully indeed. So what does constant surveillance do to the way we're represented and how we represent ourselves? And finally, what Big Brother does, I think, is to stage reality. It's a representation of reality, a staging of authenticity. Politics, increasingly, is also staged. In politics, is all our reality now staged? Can there be a reality beyond political representation? I don't know how you're doing, but it's very hot up here, for which I can only apologise. The guys told me they can't control the air conditioning in here. It's a separate thing. I've got more lights on me than you've got down here. Yeah. But you've got cameras watching you, speaking of surveillance. This was pointed out to me earlier. So any nodding off will be punished. So ideas and questions can come from just about anywhere. Now, political theorists haven't written very much about political representation in recent decades. There are some canonical theorists like Plato in ancient Greece and Rousseau in the 18th century who deeply distrusted representation in both politics and in the arts. They saw it as an enemy of truth and an enemy of authenticity. James Madison, the US founder and the fourth US president, was key to beginning a kind of historic reversal of attitudes to representation. He famously advocated electoral representation as an alternative to democracy at the birth of the United States. Democracy at that time still meant largely direct or face-to-face, not representative democracy. So over time, what Madison called a republic or representative government, which he favoured, became what we now call representative democracy. Today, representation in the form of elections and democracy are seen as going hand in glove, whereas just over 200 years ago, they were seen as near opposites. Now, the idea of representation that's underlying a lot of political research today is sometimes a simple, and I would say sometimes a simplistic one. We elect politicians, if we vote, compulsory in Australia. We elect politicians from geographical constituencies every few years, and their job is to reflect and act upon the interests of their constituents. So there have been various debates about the meaning of representation, mostly about whether elected representatives should be delegates who do whatever their constituents happen to want, or trustees who look after their constituents' interests, even if they're very different from what constituents happen to want. That's a distinction that goes back to the influential English theorist and politician Edmund Burke, who said in his famous speech to the electors of Bristol, and the words, more or less in the right order, are up there, "Your representative owes you not his industry only, but his judgment, and he betrays instead of serving you if he sacrifices it to your opinion." Now, being blunt about it, the conventional view of recent debates is, I think, too limited. So first, the interests of the constituents are taken as something given, fixed, and visible. Second, the idea of a public performance of representation by politicians is missing. Thirdly, there are several roles, including, but I think going beyond, trustee and delegate roles, which are not considered. Fourth, there's no space for anyone who is not elected to be considered as a representative. So the theory doesn't, I think, reflect sufficiently the practices of representation in, for example, an age of spin, the decline of political parties, decline in voting rates, and the rise of cross-border pressure groups. So for these and other reasons, I felt we needed to revisit the idea of representation.